Everybody's dream is to retire well. And if you want that dream to come true, you need to get involved in the process and now.
Up next, we show a few hardworking MoneyTrack viewers how to take control of their financial futures.
MoneyTrack is made possible by the Investor Protection Trust. The Investor Protection Trust is a nonprofit organization devoted to investor education. Over half of all Americans are now invested in the securities markets, making investor education and protection vitally important. Since 1993, the Investor Protection Trust has worked with states across the country to provide the independent, objective investor education needed by all Americans to make informed investment decisions.
This is MoneyTrack with Pam Kruger and Jack Gallagher, bringing you real stories and real experts to show you what works and what doesn't work when it comes to investing your money. This is MoneyTrack.
Hi, everybody. I'm Pam Kruger. Welcome to MoneyTrack.
And I'm Jack Gallagher. If you've never watched us before, Pam and I are all about helping you get the most out of your money and investment.
And on today's program, you're going to meet real MoneyTrack viewers who have emailed us that they want to share their stories and ask their questions.
And none of what we cover on MoneyTrack is over your head. You see, Pam has the financial background, and I'm sort of the regular guy who adds his 2 cents to the topics that we tackle. By the way, if you see Pam's dog Chloe roaming around, no worries, that's her job. And frankly, I think you'll agree, she does it very well.
We're actually clocking in pretty early here in the office. Of course, it's the home office.
That's right, because millions of people these days are splitting their time between the real office and the home office. That might be by choice, or it could be because of a layoff, but it seems like everybody around me is working in some sort of a hybrid situation.
You know, and I think whether you're collecting the steady paycheck or working from home in your jammies, no matter where you're clocking in and no matter what your company calls itself, you're really always working for
Me Inc.
And you know what? In about the next 25 or so minutes, you're going to meet 3 really interesting MoneyTrack viewers who have totally different work situations.
But hang on, before you go anywhere, let me explain that on your typical money show, the ones without a labradoodle running around, the host might just read a viewer's email. Not my friend Pam. She likes to get out there, meet our viewers, and meet them in their own environments. The good news is, this time, she didn't have to travel far.
My mission? Simple. To meet 3 very different people who happen to share a common goal. To somehow find more money to save for the future.
I actually wanted to be an accountant.
That's pretty cool. Money is a pretty hot topic right now, and apparently my cab driver, Mo Harb, thought so too.
The cab company, you know, should be able to buy a plan for the driver.
Okay, this was gonna be a long day. So my first real stop was about 55 miles outside San Francisco, a tiny area called Briones. On to the Coyote Ridge Ranch, a gorgeous 28-acre horse ranch where I met up with the owner, Cheryl Shorts. Now, Cheryl's been running this family business along with her 2 daughters since her divorce several years ago. And keeping a ranch of this size successful is tough work. And mind you, it's not a traditional business that offers your basic medical, dental, or 401k plan. Nope. As owner, CEO, and CFO, Cheryl has to pretty much invent her own benefits. In terms of saving for retirement, how do you feel you're doing, maybe scale of 1 to 10?
Probably a -5.
Okay, something to work on there.
Yeah.
So we talked about Cheryl's priorities, which are 1, to refinance and lower the rate on her mortgages, 2, help her daughter pay for school, and most importantly for my work today, 3, to help this single mother secure her own future.
401k does not exist. My IRA just took a tumble, like everybody else's, but the ranch has enough money coming in for my health insurance.
Okay. Give me a lot to think about here. This is a big job.
Well, it is a big job.
Yeah, it is.
Okay, so Cheryl's divorced. She's really struggling to hold on to the family ranch. This is bigger than just a basic benefits issue. Mm-hmm. And in fact, her biggest issue, from the email at least, is that she's looking for some security down the road.
Absolutely. Yeah, she's self-employed. She's a ranch owner. She doesn't get the old steady paycheck, so it's all up to her to make her security. So first, I would say, Cheryl, step back and consider what's in your control and what's outside your control. I see the urgent priority is to refinance that ranch before you slip behind on mortgage payments, which she's a little concerned about.
So what are her options? She has, what, two loans?
No, she has three loans. Oh. Now, in this environment, refinancing or reworking her three mortgage loans, believe it or not, it's entirely possible. But I actually made a few phone calls locally and talked to some banks who do special loans for ranch owners. So I think she's got a great shot at refinancing.
Okay, now she seems really intent on wanting to help both her daughters pay for college. I know the feeling.
I know everybody knows that feeling, but how realistic is it that Cheryl's really gonna be able to pony up the $10,000 or $20,000 a year or more for her, you know, 4-year education for two kids?
Right, I mean, I know, and I'm in that boat too as a parent. I know most college students can borrow money or they can go after some federal aid.
Exactly. Now, let's talk about the headline, okay? The big one is retirement. This, to me, is the big deal. She has an IRA, she hasn't touched it, and it's absolutely essential that she's contributing the maximum that the IRS will allow to this tax-advantaged account.
But this is all up to her. No 401k people nagging her, right? How should she invest?
I would probably go with like a 50-50 mix between a really good diversified stock fund and then the other half of that in very safe short or intermediate term bonds that generate income.
So we've rearranged Cheryl's financial priorities, and I don't want to have to rein you in, Pam.
Oh.
See, I can do the pun thing too, but where did our next viewer come from?
Take a look. So I left the ranch and then headed out about 35 miles due east to my next meeting at Travis Air Force Base in Fairfield. And I didn't want to be late.
I don't know what I've been told. My scrambled eggs done got cold.
I was right on time at 1000 hours. Now at Travis, there are 7,300 active duty personnel stationed on base. And I was there to get to know one 25-year-old airman who had a couple of questions for me. Sam London, married, no children, and moving every couple of years. Now, like so many others in the military, he has access to some of the most generous benefits anywhere. But he might not be taking full advantage of those military benefits, including counseling services to help him get and stay out of debt.
Probably more so my wife. We both played sports in college, so working was kind of hard. So over time, the debt started to come. And once I joined, my wife, she was kind of struggling to find a job. So she was missing payments, and it kind of the interest started to build up some.
Sam's contributing just 1% of his total pay to his thrift savings plan. That's the government's version of a 401k plan. And that's okay for now, but what about a savings cushion?
Do you have a goal for what feels comfortable as far as the amount that would be a good savings cushion?
I think if we could have just $2,000 in that account, just always never go below $2,000, that would be something that I could probably sleep a lot better with.
Now, as a new recruit, Airman London is at the bottom of the pay scale, which means he's on a super tight budget. However, his paycheck's only part of the story. Sam is actually the envy of most Americans, because if he stays in the military for another 19 years, he's going to get a real pension, and that equals 50% of his base pay.
Okay, now I've got the idea from this. Sam doesn't think he's doing enough for his retirement now.
And that was the reason he wrote in to us. In addition to his pension, he also has the federal government's equivalent of a 401k plan, the TSP. Now he's contributing, but so far hasn't paid a whole lot of attention to how that money is being invested. But I know that he has at least 10 different pretty good funds he can choose from.
Now, Sam is also, at the same point, trying to build a little cash cushion.
When military service members are deployed, they get paid a guaranteed interest rate of 10% on their savings while they're deployed. That's going to help.
The other thing is, Sam realizes that he and his wife have different, shall we say, habits when it comes to money, like a lot of couples do.
Right, and that's why he's concerned with stashing enough away, because he sees it really early on. She's just not quite as conservative as he is in the spending department. And it's not like he wants to make her wrong. He just wants to be realistic and stay on top of managing the debt.
Okay, so Sam's tweaks are, number one, talk to the on-base credit counselors about a workable plan to pay down the debt. And two, start taking full advantage of free personal finance and credit classes on base. Number three, then he can make the most of his retirement accounts. Smooth sailing from there on out.
Except he's in the Air Force.
Oh.
But do all three of those, Sam, and both you and your wife can be very happy living on less than what you actually bring home.
Well, thanks for writing in, Sam. And now our third viewer. She has a situation that's totally different from Cheryl or Sam. In this case, she has an employer, but no 401k or medical benefits. It's sort of a hybrid. So let's see where Pam goes next.
Watch this one.
Where's the break?
So from Travis Air Force Base, I headed southward to that other city by the bay, Oakland, for my final visit of the day.
Ultra Business Services, this is Micah. I'm going to help you.
By day, Micah Montgomery manages her uncle's accounting office.
I just want to go outside.
After work, her passion is music, which makes a whole lot of sense, because guess who is Micah's great uncle? Oh, yeah, jazz legend Wes Montgomery.
Summertime, and the living is easy.
Now, until Micah makes it big in the music business, which we have no doubt she will, she needs to come up with a retirement strategy just like the rest of us.
So now you're working here.
Yes.
And you do not have a 401k plan available to you.
For now, Micah and her adorable four-year-old daughter are covered by her husband's health insurance. He's an Amtrak conductor with a nice fat pension.
I'd like to know how much I need to do to be secure. You know, and then also plan that around life and everything else I need to do.
Well, it's obvious she's incredibly talented.
Yeah, and her passion is her music, and that's how she intends to earn a living in the very near future.
You know, she's typical in today's world in that she's not typical.
Yeah, because she gets a steady paycheck from the business owner. That's her uncle, the accountant.
Right.
She has full medical coverage for the entire family through her husband's work. Very smart.
So instead of paying twice for the coverage, they take full advantage of the best of both worlds. So far, so good.
Now, Micah wrote in because her challenge is to make sure that nothing valuable is falling between the cracks between her and her husband's savings and benefits. Now, for example, I would also like Micah to find out what other benefits she might take advantage of from her husband's company. You know, things like a health savings account or a flexible spending account. These are accounts that you can pay for all kinds of everyday drugstore items using pre-tax money.
Pam, I get the feeling that Micah's relying more on her husband than herself to fund that retirement account. Is that real or imagined?
Yeah, I picked up on that too, and that's not why she wrote me, but that's what I'm zooming in on, because she's only contributing $25 a month to her own individual retirement account. I would like to see her increase that.
How much more than $25?
I think she can triple it easily and add another $50 a month.
Now, the question is which type of IRA account, because everybody knows, at least you've told me, there's a ton of choices out there.
Right, and because she's on her own in that sense, in her case, she qualifies for what's called an Roth IRA. It's different from a regular or traditional IRA where you get to deduct your contribution right up front and then you have to pay taxes when you start spending the money. With the Roth, the reason people like it so much is because when you take the money out, it's tax-free forever.
Wow, that's great. And she has about, what, 30 years to let that money grow?
Yeah, she has plenty of time. She's got about $16,000 in that traditional IRA right now. So, Micah, your biggest tweak is going to start funding the Roth IRA account with more money.
But she and her husband bogged down at all by credit card debt? What's that situation?
You know, she's got a couple of student loans. and they have about $800 in debt. It's nothing that they can't pay off in maybe 3 or 4 months.
So the bottom line for Micah, getting rid of that lingering credit card debt, taking investing for retirement a lot more seriously.
You know, and build the business, but don't go broke over it. She says she's got about $10,000 into it. She's not going to put any more because she says she doesn't need to. So we really wish Micah all the best with her music career. And I hope that all three, Cheryl, Sam, and Micah, are going to keep us posted as they go.
So now you were all over the place. How'd you get home?
Oh, take a look.
One thing I'm thinking about now is to buy a house. You want to go through the Lombard Street?
Okay.
I understand that, you know, the prices are way down.
Yeah, it's a good time to buy. It really is. Thank you, Mo.
Thank you. Okay.
Well, that was very interesting. How are you feeling now? Well, all three of the viewers who emailed us are working and earning money, as you saw. What about those of you who are worried about more than just tweaking what you have at work? What if you're barely able to hang on to your paycheck, or what if you've already been laid off?
Michelle Singletary is a personal finance writer for The Washington Post. Her award-winning column, The Color of Money, is carried in more than 120 newspapers, and she's joining us now for Investing 101 with what we're going to call Plan B advice.
Michelle, let's say Plan A is at risk or worse. The job is gone.
I really put people in two categories. Those people who know that they're going to have a layoff. You've gotten that notice. You've gotten that pink slip. You may have a couple weeks or a couple months before you actually have that job layoff. And then people who are uncertain about their jobs. And so there are two different things that you should be doing. If you know that you're facing a layoff, then you've got to start making a list. What can I do? And the number one thing is that you need to start preserving cash. Now, this is going to be counter to what you heard, and you only do this in this situation. You need to stop putting money in your retirement fund.
Wait a minute. Stop putting money in your 401k?
Michelle, explain why we would do just the opposite of what we just told our three viewers to do.
You are in survival mode at this point, because if you keep piling cash into that 401k, if you can't find a job soon enough, you're going to take that money out and be hit with penalties. And so what you want to do is start to preserve cash into your emergency fund. You want to only make the minimum payments on your credit cards. Now, any other time, you're going to be piling cash on those credit cards, trying to get rid of them as fast as you can. But again, right now, you got to make sure you've got enough money to last you until you get that next job.
Just don't get too used to not funding your retirement account, right? Don't get in that habit.
Right. I mean, this is a season, and we all go through seasons. The economy goes through seasons. And so what you want to say is this is just temporary.
And a potential layoff is precisely the reason why we're supposed to have what? Six months worth of salary saved for emergency. This being that emergency.
Typically, what I recommend people is have enough money depending on the kind of job that you have. If you are a highly compensated person, if you're making, you know, over $80,000 a year to six figures, you probably need to have at least a year's worth of living expenses saved up. Because the chance of you getting a similar job at that kind of salary is slimmer in this economy when so many companies are downsizing. And so it's going to take you longer to replace that type of income. So that's 6 years. But if, like, say you're a nurse or you're a teacher, someone who you can probably get a job in a short period of time, then you can aim for that 3 to 6 months.
Good point. Now, this cushion shouldn't be invested in the stock market. Even if you believe the market's poised for a huge run-up, this is money that has to stay parked in a guaranteed bank certificate or an interest-paying checking account. But, you know, you can have two different buckets for these monies, right?
That's how I look at it. I have various accounts for my money, and I have my emergency bucket of money, and that's in a regular savings account. I'm not trying to grow it. I'm just trying to protect a principal. Then I have a bucket for what I call a life happens fund, and that's for the things in life that happens, car repairs, you know, your kids, you know, trips come up, you know, for your kids that weren't planned for. If you only save for emergencies in that emergency bucket, you'll keep pouring money out of that, and so when a true emergency comes, that bucket will be empty.
Michelle Singletary, we enjoy reading your column and so appreciate your sound advice.
Thanks, Michelle. All right, so let's assume you do have a job. Everything's going great. What happens when you find out that the guys who are managing your benefits start dipping into those contributions? Nashville, a city of big hopes and big dreams.
Hello, Nashville and the world.
But for more than 1,000 people in the Nashville area, their hopes and dreams were stolen by this man, Barry Stokes, self-proclaimed consumer-driven man, knew exactly what to say to gain trust and clients.
Also, the advent of new desktop computers makes it easier for someone to dummy up a false statement.
And that's exactly what he did. Barry was the man responsible for the 401k flexible spending and health benefit plans for more than 35,000 people working at 800 companies. Barry was hired directly by these companies as a third-party benefit administrator, so most of his victims had never even heard of Barry Stokes. However, he was close enough to their money to embezzle $19 million of it.
I think that the Madoff case shows the pattern that you will find is that monies will be sent in to the investment advisor, and then the monies are simply not invested, that they're diverted, and false statements will be created.
As founder and chief executive officer of One Point Solutions, located just outside of Nashville, he provided so-called quarterly statements on his clients' benefit accounts. He even had a website where participants could check in on their accounts daily. But in early 2002, Barry Stokes began using his clients' money for his own needs and expenses instead of investing it. He used millions of the entrusted funds to cover mounting business debts and to finance his lavish lifestyle. Barry was enjoying the good life.
What we see at the end of the day is that most con artists are motivated by greed and selfishness.
As it turns out, of the $30 million in benefit funds he collected, Stokes invested less than $2.5 million. But after 4 years of successfully cheating his customers, two large clients decided to leave One Point Solutions. Stokes couldn't cover the funds. He was forced into bankruptcy, and by September 2006, federal authorities shut down Stokes and his illegal Ponzi empire.
The Ponzi scheme is always going to collapse. Money that comes into the fraud is paid to the early investors, and on the hope that new investors continue to buy into the scheme.
Barry Stokes eventually pled guilty to 76 counts related to embezzlement and will now be living his good life behind bars.
We're seeing more fraud everywhere. And I would say it's because of the economic downturn. People are under tremendous financial stress.
Although he wouldn't discuss his case specifically, he did give us his perspective on fraud and the growing number of scam artists.
People have always had to worry about it. It's just that they weren't as aware of it, and there probably was the same amount of fraud on a percentage basis, but fewer people were investing in 401ks 20, 30 years ago.
But we won't have to worry about our investments getting into the hands of Mr. Barry Stokes. He's been banned from working in the financial industry for life.
You know, this kind of theft is actually rare, and fortunately, a new law puts new protections in place to prevent the employees from losing those contributions. Okay, let's summarize the three main points that we got from today's mini makeovers.
Today, we learned from three very different viewers that the workforce is changing a lot. Yet, having enough money in a retirement fund one day is really the most important priority for all three.
And Michelle Singletary gave us a plan B, just in case the job that you now have goes away. Now remember, if that is the concern, it's all about building up the cash reserves, even if that means everything else has to suffer temporarily.
And number three, you can control what you do with your own retirement plan, your health insurance, and other benefits at work, but you can't control what happens when an outside third party steals from your employer. Find out from your human resources department exactly how your contributions are covered if there ever is a theft.
Now, I think it's getting about that time where we're going to clock out of the old home office. What do you say?
What are you looking forward to? Maybe some downhill, high-risk scooter ride with Chloe? Maybe another horseback ride, crazy cab ride? What do you think?
Threw the boots away. I'm done. Everything that you've seen today is on our website.
That
easy to find.
MoneyTrack.org. Get there. Follow the dog. Very easy. See you next time, everybody.
Thanks for watching, everybody. My stomach's still a little upside down.
Well, I think it should be. You have to pick. You're going to ride the horse, you're going to ride the scooter. Pick one. You're crazy, author.
It's the cab that got me.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, thank God. Downhill.
Whenever you go out, get the people shot. Take a jingle.
Making me sick to my stomach, Sheldon. Not you, the camera angle. I didn't mean you were making me sick. I said it wrong. Your camera movements are making me sick to my stomach. You made me sick to my stomach when I first met you, but I'm getting used to you.